Hello students, I am VLN Swarupini, lecturer in biochemistry from Sri Venkateswara College of Arts and Sciences, which is affiliated to Adikavi Nannayya University. Today, I would like to discuss about pancreatic hormones, and this particular topic is for 3rd BSc biochemistry students, and this topic is from 5th paper, Physiology, Clinical Biochemistry and Immunology. And in the previous class, we discussed about thyroid gland, parathyroid gland hormones. And today, let's see about this pancreatic hormones. And before going into the topic, just in a very prescribed manner, just I wanted to revise this thyroid and parathyroid hormones. Why? Because remaining other units are different from this endocrinology unit. Why? Because while we are discussing hormones one by one or hormonal glands one by one, there will be entry of many number of hormones into the picture. So that if I revise for one to two times, then you can better remember these hormones and all. Okay. So first let's see about this thyroid hormone and parathyroid hormones in a brief manner, okay? So here thyroid hormones are secreted from thyroid gland, and this is present below the larynx, which is present on both sides of the trachea, okay? And coming to the major hormones that are produced from thyroid gland are T3 and T4. Apart from calcium metabolism related hormone, this T3 and T4 are principal hormones, that is thyroxine and triiodothyronine. So what is the difference between T4 and T3 regarding their structure means, in T4, that is thyroxine, presence of 4 iodine molecules is seen, whereas in T3 hormone we'll see only 3 iodine molecules. And if you observe the chemical name of this particular two hormones, T4's name is 3,5,3-5-tetraiodothyronine, okay, whereas T3's name is 3,5,3-triiodothyronine, okay. And coming to the secretion or its secretion of this particular T3 and T4 hormones is based on the uptake of iodine, okay. And this iodine is uptaken, and this is activated to the as I+ ions, okay. Conversion of iodide I- to iodine I+ will be happen, okay. And during this process of conversion of this iodide to active form is promoted by thyroid stimulating hormone, and also it has inhibitors like antithyroid drugs also. Examples, try to answer the examples. Antithyroid drugs like thiourease, thiouracil and methinazole, okay. And for the synthesis of this T3 and T4, thyroglobulin is a glycoprotein and precursor for the T3 and T4. Okay, that means both the hormones have similar precursor. Okay, both the hormones have similar precursors, and both are released from this thyroglobulin. Okay, and this is also called as thyrosine. And from this thyroglobulin, first monoiodothyrosine is formed. From this, diiodothyrosine is formed. And next form product is thyroxine, okay. And here monoiodothyrosine and diiodothyrosine combine to form T3 hormone. Okay, T4 hormone is incised in a sequential manner from this thyroglobulin to monoidothyrosin, from monoidothyrosin to diiodothyrosin, and two molecules of diiodothyrosin combined to form a thyroxine, that is T4, and one molecule of monoidothyrosin and one molecule of diiodothyrosin combined to form T3 molecule. Okay, so this is how the synthesis of this T3 and T4 is seen. And coming to the transportation, these particular T3 and T4 hormones which are combined, which are synthesized from this thyroglobulin, is transported with the help of binding proteins like thyroxine binding globulin and thyroxine binding per prealbumin. Okay, and also apart from this, major functions of this thyroxine hormones, that is T3 and T4, this is related to the metabolism in our body. Okay, and it will increase the metabolic rate in our body, and also this particular T3 and T4 hormones affect on protein synthesis, carbohydrate metabolism, lipid metabolism. That means overall function of this T3 and T4 is related to the metabolism of our body. Okay, and apart from these two T3 and T4 hormones, another hormone, that is calcitonin. Calcitonin is also produced from this gland, and this particular calcitonin is responsible for the calcium metabolism. Okay, as this T3 and T4 are helpful in the metabolism of our body, like carbohydrate, lipid, protein, but this calcitonin is responsible for the mineral metabolism and mainly calcium metabolism. Okay, and coming to abnormalities, goiter, simple endemic goiter, hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism are the abnormalities related to the thyroid hormones. Okay, goiter means enlargement of the thyroid gland due to the presence of thyroid stimulating hormone and absence of T3 and T4 hormones. And coming to simple endemic goiter, this is commonly seen in the persons who live away from the seashores, and this is mainly caused due to the lack of iodine in their diet. And also coming to hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism, hyper means this is overproduction of thyroid hormones, whereas hypothyroidism means low secretion or low percentage of thyroid hormones is seen. Okay, and this is about thyroid gland. Now let's see about parathyroid. This parathyroid hormone, it is also a major hormone, major gland related to the endocrinology, and this parathyroid gland is present near to the thyroid gland itself, and this is responsible for the secretion of parathyroid hormone, and this is synthesized from pre-proparathyroid hormone and converted into proparathyroid hormone and finally to parathyroid hormone. And this also plays a major role in the calcium metabolism. Okay, so calcitonin and this parathyroid hormone both are responsible for the calcium metabolism. Okay, and this particular parathyroid hormone shows its activity on three specialized organs, that is on bones, on kidneys and on intestine. And majorly this parathyroid hormone is responsible for the absorption of this calcium. Okay, so from kidneys it reabsorbs the calcium, and in bones it decalcifies the calcium, and from intestine it absorbs the calcium from the food material that we take. Okay, this is all about yesterday's class, and now let's move on to the today's class, that is pancreatic hormones. So this is a pancreas is a special gland, okay, and this particular pancreas is both exocrine and endocrine gland. That means exocrine gland, which is a gland which will secrete the hormones into the outside, okay. And coming to the endocrine gland, this particular endocrine glands will secrete hormones into the body through specialized ducts, okay. So this is the difference between exocrine and endocrine. So this particular pancreas hormone shows both exocrine and endocrine characters, okay. The exocrinal part secretes pancreatic fluid into the duodenum after the meal, and the endocrinal part secretes various types of hormones into the ducts, okay. So coming to the exocrinal characteristic of this pancreas, it will secrete pancreatic fluid into the duodenum after the meal. Whenever we take a meal or we eat something, immediately after this, what will happen? Our body will respond and pancreas will secrete pancreatic fluid into the duodenum, okay. And coming to the endocrinal part or endocrinal characteristic, it will secrete different kinds of hormones, okay. And these are produced by specialized tissues in pancreas, and they release to the capillary system and reach the liver by the portal venous circulation, and the specialized tissue is called islets of Langerhans, okay. So in pancreas there is a special tissue, okay, that is called as islets of Langerhans, and this islets of Langerhans again contains different kinds of cells, okay. So here this islets of Langerhans contains different kinds of cells in it, and islets of Langerhans represent around 1-2% of the pancreas. That means in overall pancreas, this islets of Langerhans is 1-2% of the pancreas, and this islets of Langerhans consist of four different kinds of cells, okay. This contains four different kinds of cells. Let's see them, okay. This islets of Langerhans contain four different kinds of cells, and we name them as A cell, B cells, D cells and F cells. And here A cells are responsible for the production of glucagon, okay. And around 25% of the islets of Langerhans contain this A cells. And B cells are responsible for the production of insulin, okay. And around 60% of the islets of Langerhans is B cells, and D cells are responsible for the production of somatostatin, okay. This D cells are responsible for the production of somatostatin. And here somatostatin word we already discussed in our previous class. Just recollect about the somatostatin, okay. And this particular D cells are around 10% in the islets of Langerhans. And coming to F cells, these are responsible for the production of pancreatic polypeptide, okay. A special pancreatic polypeptide is produced or secreted from this F cells. And these F cells are around 5% of the islets of Langerhans. So if you see all these cells, what we can understand, insulin is the major hormone produced from this pancreas. That means here 60% of the B cells are present, and these will produce insulin, okay. So next, let's see the next one. Let's see the functions of this. And this islets of Langerhans play a crucial role in carbohydrate metabolism. So let's see what are those. And the first one is glycolysis, okay. We all know glycolysis is the metabolic most important metabolic pathway in which pyruvate is produced from the glucose, okay, and we call it as anaerobic conversion of glucose to lactate, okay. So glycolysis doesn't stop with the formation of pyruvate. Finally, pyruvate is again converted into lactate in anaerobic conversion, okay, and occurs in the red blood cells, renal medulla and skeletal muscles, okay. So this particular glycolysis occurs in red blood cells, renal medulla and skeletal muscles. This is a SK, not SC, okay. So in different kinds of cells, this particular glycolysis takes place, and this pancreas plays islets of Langerhans plays an important role in the carbohydrate metabolism of this glycolysis, okay. And the next one is glycogenesis. Glycogenesis is nothing but synthesis of glycogen from glucose, okay. The stored glucose is converted into glycogen, okay, and this glycogen is the stored form of glucose in it, okay. Don't get confused. Glucose which is taken into our body is deposited in liver and muscle, is converted into glycogen, and this is the stored form of glucose, okay, and this serves to maintain a constant plasma glucose concentration, okay. This particular glycogenesis is responsible for the maintenance of plasma glucose concentration. Whenever our plasma is in low concentration for glucose, then immediately this glycogen, okay, will break down to form glucose with the glycogenolysis process, okay. And the next one is glycogenolysis, and with this process, glycogen is converted into glucose in whenever our body require glucose, okay. And the next one is gluconeogenesis, the production of glucose from non-sugar molecules, okay. This is production of glucose from non-sugar molecules like amino acids, lactate, glycerol, etc., okay. And this is also an important carbohydrate metabolic pathway. And the next one is lipolysis. Okay, next one is lipolysis. The breakdown of triacylglycerols into glycerol and free fatty acids. And the other one is lipogenesis, synthesis of triacylglycerol. So, these are the different pathways of carbohydrate metabolism and lipid metabolism in which these islets of Langerhans play crucial role. So now let's see ultimately the functions of this pancreas, okay. Till now we discussed about islets of Langerhans, now we are seeing about the functions of pancreatic hormones. These pancreatic hormones are responsible for storage of fat and glucose, okay. As we all know, glucose is stored in the form of glycogen, and fats are also stored, okay. And excuse me, and this enables the mobilization of energy reserves as a result of food deprivation, stress and physical activities. So during food deprivation or stress, or during physical activities, that means whenever our body is starving for energy, okay, when we are not taking food for couple of days or couple of hours, what will happen? Ultimately our body will require energy, but we are not taking any food material, then it utilizes the stored content. And if the duration of that particular starvation is prolonged, then obviously what will happen? All the reserves in our body will be utilized, and finally our body will require energy. So And during this process of starvation, stored energy is mobilized and it is moved from one place to other to give energy to our body. And this particular mobilization of energy through in our body is during food deprivation, that means during lack of food or during stress. Whenever we are in stress levels also, what will happen? We'll not take proper food and then also we'll have starvation, okay, a little bit of starvation. And whenever we are going huge amount of physical activity, okay, then stored energy will be utilized fastly for the functioning of our body. Okay, so for all these purposes, energy mobilization is done with the help of pancreatic hormones and maintain the constant plasma glucose concentration and also promote growth. Okay, so plasma glucose concentration is also maintained with the help of these pancreatic hormones, and also ultimately all these hormones are responsible for the promotion of growth, that means to increase growth in individuals. Okay, so these are the major functions related to pancreatic hormones. And now let's see about the pancreatic hormones individually. And the first one and the major one is insulin. Okay, so insulin is the major and important hormone secreted from the pancreas, and this particular insulin is produced from the beta cells of the islets of Langerhans. And firstly, let's see about the structure of this insulin. And insulin is a protein consisting of an alpha chain, and this alpha chain contains 20 amino acid long linked at a 30 amino. This creates a benzoic Bix acid beta chain via 2 disulfide bridges. That means this is a peptide hormone, and it contains an alpha 21 chain amino acids and a 30 amino acid beta chain. Okay, so it contains 2 chains, alpha chain and beta chain. Alpha chain contains 21 amino acids and beta chain contains 30 amino acids, and these two are diffused combined with 2 disulfide bridges. Okay, and the precursor to insulin is preproinsulin. Okay, precursor for this insulin is preproinsulin, which contains a single sequence that is further removed in the endoplasmic reticulum, converting the precursor into its prohormone referred to as proinsulin. Okay, firstly, a preproinsulin is the precursor, and this is converted into prohormone, that is proinsulin. Okay, and this process occurs in the endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, and proinsulin is converted into insulin after removal of a C peptide from the prohormone. Okay, this proinsulin is converted into insulin by the removal of a C peptide from the prohormone, that is proinsulin. Okay, and the insulin receptor consists of 2 extracellular alpha subunits and 2 transmembranous beta subunits. Okay, as discussed before, this insulin contains alpha subunits and also 2 alpha subunits and 2 beta subunits. And alpha subunits are in extracellular subunits, whereas beta subunits are transmembranous subunits. When insulin is near the receptor, it binds to the alpha subunits of the receptor, and this binding leads to the autophosphorylation of the beta subunits of the insulin receptor. These beta subunits then act as receptor tyrosine kinases that phosphorylate insulin receptor subunits, and the signal then travels downstream to intracellular proteins. Okay, so what is the function related to this insulin is, okay, during the function of this insulin, what will happen? This will bind to the alpha subunit of the receptor. Okay, so as this insulin contains and receptors for its action, okay, to show its activity, it should bind to an receptor, and that particular receptor contains alpha subunits, and that particular insulin will bind to alpha subunit of the receptor. And by binding of this alpha onto this alpha receptor, beta subunit which is present in the insulin will be autophosphorylated, and these beta subunits then act as receptors, thyrokinases then phosphorylate insulin receptor subunits, and signal will be passed to the cellular proteins. Okay, if you see the diagram, insulin will be bound to the receptor, and finally by phosphorylation what will happen? Signal will be produced so that glucose is transported into the cell. Okay, so glucose insulin metabolism this is. Okay, if you see the diagram here, glucose is near to the cell, and what happened? First insulin is bind to the receptor, and after receptor what will happen? It transfer stimulus, and after passing of the stimuli to the proteins, what will happen? These glucose molecules will enter the cell, and they undergo conversion into glycogen. Okay, that means some part of the glucose is converted into storage form, that is glycogen, and again these are converted into the other metabolic pathways, and finally they produce pyruvate. Okay, so some quantity of the glucose is converted into glycogen, which is a stored form, and after that pyruvate is formed. Okay, and finally after pyruvate formation, these will enter lipid metabolism, and fatty acids are produced. So this is how insulin is influencing all the metabolic pathways in our body. Okay, firstly it is helpful for the entry of this glucose molecules into the cell, and where this glucose will undergo multiple metabolic pathways, like and this will responsible for the production of different components like glycogen, pyruvate, fatty acids and all. Okay, so this is about the function of insulin, and now let's see how this particular insulin is regulated. Okay, insulin is mainly secreted in a response to increase in the blood levels of glucose. Higher level of glucose cause that glucose enter the B cell and is converted into glucose 6-phosphate. This creates the cytosolic ATP and lead to the closure of ATP gated K plus channels and then to depolarization. Okay, firstly what will happen? This insulin firstly is secreted in response to the high glucose levels in the blood. So whenever blood contains high glucose level only, this insulin is secreted. Okay, so this insulin is not ready for the action before the entry of the glucose. This insulin is produced only when this blood glucose levels are high, and by presence of high concentration of glucose in the blood, what will happen? This will stimulate this pancreas to produce insulin from the beta cells of islets of Langerhans. Okay, then after secretion of this insulin, what will happen? Glucose can enter the cell. Okay, the higher concentration of glucose which is present near the cell will enter the cell. Okay, high level of glucose causes that glucose enter the
beta cells and is converted into glucose 6 phosphate. Okay, glucose is converted into glucose 6 phosphates, and this is the first step in many catabolic pathways like glycolysis and all. Okay, in glycolysis, what is the first step? Glucose, which is which enters the cell, is converted into glucose 6 phosphate, and this is a ATP dependent reaction. Okay, glucose is converted into glucose 6 phosphate by the enzyme hexokinase, or in few cells by glucokinase. Okay, and these both enzymes are ATP dependent, and they utilize ATP. And whenever they use this is a cytosolic ATP, this leads to closure of ATP gated K plus channels. Okay, that means our cells will contain Na plus K plus ion channels. Okay, and by cytosolic ATP, what will happen? This K plus channels will be closed and depolarization is occurs. Okay, depolarization causes an opening of voltage gated Ca 2 plus channels. Okay, here Na plus K plus channel is depolarized. Okay, that means this is inhibited. Now with this inhibition, this Ka2 plus channels, that is calcium ion channels, will be open, and the level of cytosolic Ca2 plus ion rises and initiates an exocytosis of insulin and reopening of K plus ions. Okay, whenever Ka2 plus increases, this insulin is undergoes exocytosis, and by the exocytosis process of insulin, what will happen? Again Na plus K plus channel will be reopened, and insulin secretion is stimulated during digestion via acetylcholine. Okay, that means during the process of digestion of these carbohydrates, insulin secretion is stimulated by the chemical acetylcholine, and this is secreted from vagus nerve. Okay, during the discussion of digestion of carbohydrates, we discussed about this vagus nerve. Okay, and this acetylcholine is secreted from vagus nerve, and gastrin, secretin, secretin, secretin. These are the few components which inhibit the insulin secretion during the digestion of this glucose. Okay, so because for if not, what will happen? This insulin again will act on that particular glucose. Okay, without proper digestion only, this insulin will act on the glucose. To avoid that, these particular components will inhibit the secretion of insulin, and certain amino acids as a arginine, leucine also stimulate secretion, as well as free fatty acids and some steroid hormones. The secretion is inhibited via epinephrine and norepinephrine. So inhibition is completely achieved by epinephrine and norepinephrine. These are the hormones which are related to which gland? These epinephrines, endorphins, these are related to the pituitary gland. Okay, so these will inhibit the insulin production. These are activated when hypoglycemia is detected by central chemoreceptors. Okay, so finally this insulin is regulated with the help of epinephrines and norepinephrines. Okay, so just this is enough for you regarding the regulation. Now let's see about the function of the insulin. So this insulin has an anabolic and lipogenic effect, and it promotes the storage of glucose in the liver and also activates enzymes to promote glycolysis and glycogenesis. Okay, here, excuse me, this insulin is most importantly responsible for the anabolic and lipogenic effects. Okay, and it will promote the storage of glucose in the liver and also activates enzyme to promote glycolysis and glycogenesis. And in addition, it promotes the uptake and storage of amino acids in the form of proteins and promotes growth. Okay, so how this insulin will help in the growth promotion is, it will uptake and store amino acids in the form of proteins. Insulin also increases the amount of GLUT4, that is glucose transporters, and glucose transporters in skeletal myocytes. Okay, and this will help for the glucose entry. And glucose can enter the cell in two different ways, one with sodium as a secondary active transport and the other one is through glucose transporters. Okay, so glucose can enter any cell based on sodium channel or with the help of glucose transporters. Okay, and the next hormone is glucagon. So this is produced from the A cells of the islets of Langerhans from pancreas, and this glucagon is a peptide derived from proglucagon. This proglucagon is also called as glycentin. Okay, glycentin. Glucagon secretion is stimulated by amino acids, arginine and alanine. Okay, amino acids, alanine and arginine are responsible for the glucagon secretion and from digested proteins. Okay, so these arginine and alanine, which are responsible for the glucagon secretion, are from the digested proteins and also by hypoglycemia as a result of physical exercise. Okay, whenever a person is having a hypoglycemia condition during high exercise, then that person also body will also produce glucagon, and sympathetic impulses lead to this glucagon secretion, and secretion is inhibited by glucose, somatostatin and high plasma concentrations of free fatty acids. Okay, so here this glucagon secretion is stimulated by arginine, alanine, amino acids, and a symptomatic impulse is also helpful, and also hypoglycemia condition leads to glucagon secretion. And coming to inhibition, glucose and somatostatin and also high plasma concentration of free fatty acids will inhibit the glucagon production. And here the word somatostatin, again we crossed with this word somatostatin. Hope you recollected the word. What is somatostatin? So somatostatin is nothing but growth hormone releasing inhibiting hormone. Okay, growth hormone release inhibiting hormone. Okay, hope you recollected that. So this glucagon is inhibited by somatostatin, glucose and high concentration of free fatty acids. And coming to function of this glucagon, glucagon mainly is a antagonized insulin. Okay, it's a kind of antagonized insulin, and the signal from glucagon receptor is spread via CAMP, that is cyclic AMP, which is a secondary messenger. Okay, so the CAMP will give glucagon signal for the glucagon receptors, and glucagon increases glycogenolysis in the liver and stimulates gluconeogenesis from lactate, and protein degradation and lipolysis. So these are the different kinds of functions of this glucagon, and this gets a signal through CAMP. And what are the functions? Increase in the glycogenolysis, and this occurs in liver, and it stimulates gluconeogenesis from lactate, and also helpful in the protein degradation and also in the lipolysis process. And its main role is to maintain the normal blood glucose level between meals to ensure a constant energy supply. Okay, so if you take any food, okay, while after taking our food, blood glucose levels will be automatically high as we have taken food. But during the gap between any two meals, our blood glucose levels will be less. But that particular blood glucose, lower level of blood glucose is maintained with the help of this glucagon. Okay, and this will lead to constant energy supply in our body. And the next one is somatostatin. This somatostatin is released from D cells of the islets of Langerhans in pancreas, and we can also call this somatostatin as growth hormone release inhibiting hormone. Okay, and somatostatin is released in response to higher plasma concentration of glucose and arginine. Okay, if this plasma concentration of glucose and arginine is high, then the somatostatin will be secreted, and through pancreatic pathways inhibit the release of insulin and also the secretion of glucagon. So the function of the somatostatin is to inhibit the release of insulin and glucagon secretion. So the somatostatin will inhibit the release and secretions of insulin and glucagon. During the deficiency of glucose, this process does not occur due to the release of catecholamines that inhibit the secretion of somatostatin. Okay, so during high level or high concentrations of glucose or energy in our body, the somatostatin should be actively worked so that this insulin and glucagon will be inhibited. And during the deficiency of glucose, this insulin and other glucagon hormone should not be inhibited. That's why this somatostatin is inhibited by catecholamines. Okay, this is the major function related to somatostatin. And major disorder related to this particular pancreas is diabetes mellitus. Okay, so major and important disorder related to pancreas is diabetes mellitus, and we all know how danger is this diabetes mellitus. And it is danger when proper measures are not taken, and if any patient with diabetes mellitus is properly taking their diet and maintaining their better hobbies and all, they can better fight with this diabetes. But if any person is not maintaining their food diet or other habits, then this diabetes is really a dangerous one. Okay, and around more than 50% of our population is with diabetes nowadays. Okay, and we all know diabetes is again of two types, type 1, type 2. And also apart from this type 1 and type 2, there is another diabetes, that is diabetes during a congestion gestation period. Okay, we call it as congestive diabetes. And these three diabetes are kinds of diabetes, and this diabetes during gestation period is only seen during that time, and after delivery of the baby what will happen is the diabetes will be cured. Okay, and coming to this type 1 and type 2, this type 1 diabetes is a insulin dependent one. Okay, and this that means there is a deficiency of insulin. Okay, deficiency, there is a less quantity of insulin produced in that particular individual. And another one is non-insulin dependent, and this is caused by the shortage of insulin receptors. Okay, so this in type 1 diabetes there will be no proper or sufficient amount of insulin to work for the entry of this glucose into the cells. Whereas in type 2 diabetes what happens is insulin will be present, but recognition of insulin by the insulin receptors will not occur. So this is type 1 and type 2. In both cases the level of glucose in blood is increased, and this leads to glycosuria and polyuria and polydipsia. So these are the few conditions which are related to this diabetes mellitus, and this diabetes is treated with the mainly type 1 diabetes is treated with the administration of insulin as medicines, or through pills or through injections. This insulin is given to the patients, and this blood glucose levels will be maintained. Okay, and lipolysis is no longer inhibited. Fatty acids are liberated in large quantities. Fatty acids can be used as a source of energy, although this leads to formation of acetoacetic acid and acetone. Okay, so as this glucose is not properly available for the cells in these diabetic patients, fatty acids will be a better alternative for the glucose. Okay, these can be acted as sources of energy, but through high amount of lipid metabolism what will happen is ketone bodies will be formed. Okay, ketone bodies like acetoacetic acid and acetone will be produced by ketosis process, and as a result of so many fatty acids the liver begins to store triacylglycerols, which leads to the development of fatty liver, and it is another disorder disease. Okay, so anything is dangerous. Okay, even though if our body is utilizing fatty acids, it leads to fatty liver, or if it is not using fatty acids, what will happen? Insulin will be increased in the blood level, and this leads to glycosuria, polyuria and polydipsia. So these are the disorders related to this particular pancreas. Okay, so this is about insulin and diabetes, and in this class we have discussed about pancreatic hormones, and pancreas consists of islets of Langerhans, a special tissue, and it contains four kinds of cells, and here A cell is responsible for the glucagon production, B cell is responsible for the insulin production, and D cell is responsible for the somatostatin production, and we have seen about their functions. And also, apart from the individual functions of those hormones, this pancreas is in overall is helpful in the different kinds of metabolic pathways like glycolysis, glycogenesis, glycogenolysis, gluconeogenesis, lipolysis, lipogenesis. And coming to functions, it plays major role in the carbohydrate metabolism and in the energy mobilization, and for the maintenance of plasma glucose concentration and for the promotion of growth. Okay, so this is about this pancreatic hormones. Okay, so Thank you, students. Please verify these classes for 1 to 2 times and keep the material provided for you with you while listening to the class. And also, if you have any doubts, please contact me. Thank you, students.